Hello, and welcome to the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art at Utah State University, or as we often call it, NEMA. Today we are going to explore our new exhibition, The Day After Tomorrow. Consider how artwork can represent our experiences and create a piece of original artwork. This exhibition showcases art created in response to turmoil and hope. Artists chronicle people's experiences over time. If something is important, whether it be a problem, a victory, a significant event, a tradition, or a legend, it is usually reflected in the artwork that people make. NEMA is a Western American modern art museum, meaning that most of the artwork you see in our museum was made over the last 100 years in the Western part of America. The artwork talks about things that are important to us in these times, including diseases, the environment, traffic jams, computers, and more. Let's take a closer look at several artworks from this exhibition and see how these artists use art to represent their experiences with turmoil and hope. This underwater photograph, Bliss, by artist Kendon North, expresses a sense of a different state of existence. When talking about her art, Kendon North said, "Being underwater is a state of buoyancy, fluidity, and weightlessness. In this state of being submerged, we are brought to a place of sensory awareness and uncertain reality. In the photograph, Bliss, light, reflections, and the confusion of materials and figure produce a mysterious world defined by light." When you look at this photograph, what thoughts and feelings do you experience? What words would you use to describe it? Does it remind you of anything from your own life? Does it remind you of a dream? This painting, The Last of the Buffalo, by Margaret Nielsen, is interesting because it is what we call an appropriation. What this means is the artist looked at another painting, recreated it, and added her own elements to it. The original painting was created by Albert Bierstadt in 1888 and was painted when there were less than 600 buffalo remaining in the United States. When Margaret Nielsen created this painting in 1990, she added an angel gleaming in the sky, hand outstretched and eyes closed, as if trying to intervene in what is happening on the ground. She said, "My edition of the angel is about collective loss and grief, and the fantasy that there could be an archetypal protectress of people, of an ecosystem, of everybody, especially now." What do you see when you look at this painting? What story do you think the original artist, Albert Bierstadt, was telling? How did Margaret Nielsen change the story by adding her own elements to the art? What elements of this painting make you think of turmoil or hope?
Inspired by the art we have seen, we are going to create our own abstract artwork. It will have special meaning to you. It will blend together something about you and something you hope for in the future. We're going to use a scientific process called chromatography to create our artwork.
What do you know about mixing colors? You probably already know that you can mix two colors together to make a new color. For example, yellow and blue mixed together will make green. And there are several colors combined to create the dye in a brown marker. What do you know about molecules? A molecule is the smallest unit of a substance that still has all the properties of that substance. A water molecule, or H2O, can be divided into tinier parts called atoms, but it would no longer be water, but two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. Let's do a little chemistry and art together. If you want to separate the mixture of chemicals on a molecular level into individual parts, you can use a scientific tool called chromatography, which literally means color writing. Chromatography works to separate unseen materials by dissolving them in a liquid and allowing them to move through something absorbent like paper. Each substance will start and stop moving at a different rate because of the way the individual molecules are built. each substance will leave a distinct trail behind. Think of chromatography as a race. Waiting on the starting line, you've got a mixture of chemicals, just like runners, all mixed up and bunched together. They're in a stationary phase. When the race starts, they enter a mobile phase. Runners soon begin to spread out because of their different abilities. In exactly the same way, chemicals in a compound will spread out because they travel at different speeds over the stationary solid. Scientists can then analyze and study the individual components to see what makes up that particular compound. Scientists use this method of separation in many important ways. Many materials that appear to be one thing are actually a combination of things. Using chromatography, scientists can determine how much pollution is in the water. They can detect drugs in bodies. They even use the same ink chromatography that we are going to do today to solve crimes by matching documents found at a crime scene to a marker or a pen that belongs to a suspect. Let's go back to our brown marker. Which colors do you think are used to create this brown marker? Do you think the same chemicals and colors are used to make a black marker? Let's do an experiment and find out. For this experiment, we will need several markers. We're going to use black, brown, green, and purple, but you can pick whatever colors you'd like. A couple of coffee filters. Coffee filters are a great stationary solid because they're absorbent. Cups and water, black construction paper, and a white pencil. First, I'm going to draw a thick line about 2.5 inches from the center of the coffee filter. Now I'm going to fold the coffee filter to make a point at the bottom and put it in my cups of water. I want the tip of my filter to get in the water, but I don't want the marker to touch the water. Now what we have to do is wait. What do we see happening? Are the colors that are separating the ones you expected? Are there different shades of the same color or unexpected colors? The colors that we see furthest from the original line are the chemicals that are the fastest. Now we will put that science to work to create an abstract masterpiece. Thoughtfully select two colors to use. Cut your coffee filter into a rectangle. That will be your canvas. On one half, an inch or so from the bottom, you'll write your initial in the marker color. This will represent you. On the other side, you will write or draw a symbol of something you hope for, something you want to be a part of your life, perhaps something you hope to do or be in the future. This will take some thought. You may want to choose your color according to this hope. By soaking one end of the coffee filter in the water, and then the other end, the molecules will travel toward the middle and blend together to create a beautiful abstract painting. Use what you know about chromatography to achieve your artistic vision. Turn it when you're happy with the way it looks, or don't turn it around at all. The choice is yours. Be sure to let your artwork dry. When it is dry, you can glue your artwork to a piece of black paper to give it a more polished look, or find another way to display it. Take some time to think of a great title. Once you have your title, you can write it in white pencil on the black paper. Be sure to sign it as well. Congrats, you're now a chromatography scientist and an abstract artist.
Thank you for joining us here at NEMA to learn more about our exhibition, The Day After Tomorrow, and consider how artists respond to turmoil and hope. I hope you have enjoyed exploring a few of our favorite artworks, experimenting with chromatography, and creating your own abstract art.